All right. Well, I'm glad that you all are here this morning. We've been talking about steps. And why have we been talking about steps? Well, I'll tell you why. At the end of every month, at the very last Monday of every month, your pastors get together and we all pray. This is the pastors and the associate pastors. And the four of us pray and we just ask God, what is coming? What are you doing? Because we always say there's no worse place to be than where God was, right? So sometimes we stay put, but if the glory cloud moves, we say, where are you going, Lord? Where are you going? And then we put our ear, you know, our, up to his mouth. And so at the end of July, he started talking to us about steps. Steps. And I think this is really important because some people don't know what their first step is out of a situation. Some people don't know what their first step is in meeting a goal. And so it's a very practical message, but it's also one that we hope to explore with you in a way that maybe some things that you've never thought about before. Sometimes you need to just stand, right? Ephesians 6:13 says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to resist in the evil day and stand firm, having done all else. Stand firm. So I like standing too. Sometimes you have to rest. Exodus 34:21 tells us to do this. 6 days you shall labor, but on the seventh day you shall rest. Even during plowing season and harvest, you must rest. How awesome we serve a God that makes us take a day off every week. And I am a living testimony that if you will do it, if you will only work for 6 days, add to that, get good sleep every night, which I used to not do. Now I do. If I go to bed late, because I do like the late hours, I try to stay in that 8 hours. I try to do it. And yet somehow, miraculously, I still get done more than I used to. And I got a lot done back then when I was sleeping, you know, 4 hours a night. But I'm now sleeping more, getting more done, and I'm convinced that the secret to productivity is keeping the Sabbath. And I don't want to argue with you on what day that is, okay? I'm just saying that is the God that we serve. So yes, I love standing, and yes, I love rest. But there are times when you need to go forward. And we are, you know, in our Rams, which we're going to do at the end of the service today, we're on this little hashtag thing now, hashtag up, not forward. So I'm going to talk to you about both today. But first of all, I don't know if you have ever noticed or not, but on the Eastgate logo, if you can go to it, right down in that little corner, that's actually part of our logo. It's the little push pin. You are here. So I want you to keep that in mind today. Figure out where you are. Okay? Before you can know where to go, you have to know where you are. So that's what we're going to do, and that's where we're going to start. Maybe you can already even now begin to picture in your mind and in your spirit, man, you know, where you need to be in your marriage. Or maybe it's at your job. Maybe it's in your own matters of self-control and discipline and character. Maybe it's in your health. Maybe it's financially where you would just really like to be. But wherever that is, you are here now, okay? That's not speaking faith. That's not, you know, moving in doubt. But it is the fact. The truth is that you're supposed to be somewhere else, okay? But the fact is that you're here right now today. We were talking this last week about that little song that Prophet Kim Clement used to have us sing 25 years ago, you know, you're somewhere in the future and you look much better than you look right now. He'd say, turn to somebody to your left and say it. You're somewhere in the future and you look much better than you look right now. And we were singing this driving down the interstate and we got off at, what's Frisbee? Church Street? I don't know. And we turned at each other and we looked at each other and we said, we are living what we pictured back then 25 years ago when we sang that to each other. we're there. All those things we were dealing with there and back then, we're not dealing with them anymore. In many ways, those were just bears and lions. Now we got Goliaths, you know. Oh my goodness, the 20, 30-year-old us thought those were Goliaths. I miss those Goliaths, don't you? But new levels, new devils. And so we had to encourage each other through those times when we just didn't know if that mountain was going to melt. And you're going to have to do that to yourself. I've looked in my mirror and sang that to myself. Sing it with me again. I want you to know it. I want to see everybody's lips moving. Stand up. Okay? You're somewhere in the future, and you look much better than you look. Don't laugh, Brando. Sing it to Abby. In the future, and you look much better than you look right now. You're somewhere in the future. I want to see your cheeks. Look much better than you look right now. You're somewhere in the future, and you look much better than you look right now. Amen. Okay, have a seat. Now, check back with me. Maybe in the year 2047, I'm kidding, it's going to be before then, but it just hit us this last week. We're in that future now, and we look much better than we did back then. I knew some of y'all then. We used to stand and sing those song, that song together. Woo, okay. So today, what we're going to do is I have a million little silly and significant images and visual aids for you, and we're going to throw all of them in, against the wall and see which one of them stick to inspire you, okay? I'm serious. I tried to think of everything. Some of you are auditory learners. You're going to get this. Some of you are visual learners, and you're going to see things. We got some things to pull out today, visual aids. Where did the Elliots go? Sam, I know you love visual aids. I think of you every time we have, I know, excess visual aids. Anyway, so for every learner today, surely, surely you will walk away with the understanding of how important your steps are to getting you to that future. All right? So first thing I'm going to do is show you some popular stepping songs and shows, theme songs, those type of things, pictures of those from, let's see, I don't even remember what the first one is. Oh, yeah, remember this show? Step by step. Day by day. Remember that? Okay, Patrick Duffy and, yeah. Oh, remember this one? That's okay. Remember these guys? New Kids on the Block? Step by step. Okay, so these are, some of you may remember these. I bet you'll all remember this next one, though. Whitney Houston, remember her? God rest her soul. What a talent. Okay, next one. Put this one in there for Pastor Brittany. Do you know how to do the Texas two-step? Well, okay. Okay, no, not here. I was about to. Okay, no, I'm kidding. Okay, so there are just some things there that really, I can't even remember. Let's go on to the next one. I think there are some here that, yeah, these are some of my personal favorite steps picks. This is Genesis taking her first steps. She actually walked for the first time in Colorado at Cindy Jacobs' house. Very prophetic. Cindy's real proud of that. This was right before that moment, but it was quite a moment. First steps are important. Okay, next. This is one of my favorite. This was my cover pick for like 3 years on Facebook. I love this picture. I just love walking pictures. I love the concept of moving forward. And you all have heard me say, if you fall, fall forward. If you sense you're in the middle of a fall and you're too far down, you cannot get back up, you've done it, just go forward. Don't ever fall backwards, whatever you do. So this is why I love this concept of moving forward and walking picks. Okay, what's the next one here? Oh, this is one of my favorite walking picks. Yes, I'm looking at him. I'm saying, you're ours. This was at Jason and Brittany's wedding in 2013. I'm like, your people will be my people, Donovan. There's a whole story behind that. This is me walking into the Metro Courthouse. Chris snapped this picture. I was filing a case a couple of 3 years ago, and again, I was walking toward what I knew I was supposed to be doing, but those were some intrepid steps, were they not? Okay. Next. Okay, now this one is interesting. Isn't a step a musical? That's a musical term, like up a step, back half a step. Okay, this is Jude giving Chris guitar lessons. That's Jude giving Chris his first guitar lesson. I think probably like in a diaper, I'm not sure. But anyway, yeah, definitely. I like the ponytail too. So pretty good. He's still giving guitar lessons. Yeah, this picture didn't really have anything, like it has steps in it, but I just wanted an excuse to show a picture of Arlo. Isn't that the cutest thing ever? So that's a favorite step picture. All right. And then I took, let's go on to the next step. This is some of our favorite, whenever we go on a trip and we're walking and walking and walking, which this was our UK trip, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago, and we went to Scotland and Wales, and some of these are in England and some are in Ireland, I think. And sometimes we'll be walking so much and I'll just literally just put my camera down and just do like this. And that's what that was on this trip. We wound up walking 28 miles during those 12 days. And this particular one was at the airport, almost missing our flight because they had canceled one and rerouted us, and I was about to die right there on that escalator. And then, we walked a total of 28 miles that week, and I had a little stepometer telling us, and that was the very end. So I've been kind of going through a lot of our photos and looking at those, and then I decided to go to Facebook and try to go through some of yours. Let's look at this next one here. Yeah, I think these are these first, is that his first steps? That's little Ezra. Oh my goodness, so cute. Okay, the next one. Now this is an old one. This is Hannah and Ryland from several years ago. I actually screenshotted it from a video. Now this is from the Gray household. You see I have circled up there the word baby steps. She said they don't eat fruit. Her boys don't eat fruit, but during the 30-day faith detox, they started enjoying fruit, baby steps. Please tell me this has had a good ending. Don't shake your head at me. Okay, so baby steps, you have to just, I'm trying to give you every visual aid, remember, so that you can remember what and why steps are important. Okay, next. Oh yeah, the steps to the 30-day faith detox. Next. These are dance steps. Dance steps are important too, I guess. So this would be Dr. Ming Wang, our friend. We went to a dance competition last week and watched him sweep all the first place medals. That was amazing. He'll be here speaking, by the way, next month, it looks like. So, okay. Let's go forward. Another step picture. And I think that is Jack. And I don't have my glasses on. That is Jack. Oh, that's Winnie. That's not Jack. That's Winnie. She has red hair in some pictures. Okay. And Ezra and, of course, Rylan there. But again, another step picture. Chad, are there important steps in Frisbee? Yeah. Thought so. Yeah, yeah, Chad. Oh, listen, nobody likes to get on Chad. He's like just, okay, and he catches it. All right, what about in soccer, Genesis? Are there important steps in soccer? Where are you? There you is. Yep, number 13, most definitely. And I think Jude and Brando can teach you some dance steps, can't they? Can you do that? You guys have an anniversary coming up soon, too, right? Number 3, happy 3rd anniversary. All right. Now, there is a very special walking scene in a movie. Hold off on this just a second. But you know what it is. It's from Pride and Prejudice. It's where Mr. Darcy is walking across that long field to Elizabeth Bennet. It is the longest 60-second walk, in my opinion. 60 seconds is a long time on screen, okay? That's a long time. And it is the longest 60-second walk, emotional, so romantical, as he's heading towards her in the field and that music is playing. So I have to play this 60 seconds. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Darcy.
That was 6 years ago at a soccer match at Genesis. Isn't that great? It's the best 60 seconds in film. Absolutely. That's what I see when you're walking towards me. Yeah. Okay, so have I convinced you steps are very important? Moving forward is very important. Whether it's music steps, dance steps, life steps, career steps, relationship steps, you got to start somewhere. And I want to just take this moment and congratulate all the Thrive candidates from yesterday. Eastgate's new members. Is Joe here? He's not here. I see this in the back. Joe, welcome to Eastgate. He kept saying, am I going to pass Thrive? We welcome you, Joe. And then, of course, Onye, stand up. Welcome back to Eastgate. Can't wait to meet your doctor husband. Now, that you guys are from one of our favorite places. It's North England, right? Yes. So welcome. I am so happy that you did that. I hope you learned a lot about Eastgate and about yourself. That's what really Thrive is about, is learning a lot about your own giftings. Okay, welcome. And then Deshaun, where is Deshaun? There he is. Stand up, Deshaun. All right. It's hard to say welcome. You're already family. But we love you so much. And we are doing all with you. We are standing with you, we're resting with you, and we're moving forward with you all at the same time. Amen. So Proverbs 16:9 says, the mind of man plans his ways, but the Lord directs his steps. So today, you're going to be getting some inkling, some inspiration about your next steps in life, in many different areas of your life. And I want you to take notes, put it on your phone, whatever you need to do. The Holy Spirit's going to speak things to you that I never can, because he knows your situation. He knows the prayers you're praying. He knows. God knows everything. So you're going to have to do that. And I hope that he will, I know that he will speak to you during this time. But what even are steps? I want to define some of these, okay? Definition of steps. Let's just look at the first one. It's a noun. It's an act or movement of putting one leg in front of the other in walking or running. The distance covered by a step, a person's particular way of walking. One of the sequences of movement of the feet that make up a dance, a short or easily walked distance, there's more. A flat surface, especially one in a series, on which to place one's foot when moving from one level to another. A doorstep, a rung of a ladder, that's important. Pairs of steps, a step ladder, step and aerobics, a foothold cut in a slope of ice, next. A measure or action, especially one of a series taken in order to deal with or achieve a particular thing, that's important. There's steps in your steps, okay? A stage in a gradual process, a particular position or grade on an ascending or hierarchical scale, an interval in a scale, a tone or a semitone. And I didn't put this next one. There's actually a fifth and a sixth one. One is a physics term, and one is a navigational term, like a nautical term, okay? So all kinds of different steps. Now, there's a verb also, step, and it means lift and set down one's foot or one foot after the other in order to walk somewhere or move to a new position. That makes sense? Used as a polite or deferential way of asking someone to walk a short distance for a particular purpose. Please step this way. Got it? Take a particular course of action. And then here's another one of the nautical as a verb, and that is to set up in its steep, like to put a mast up in its steep. So now you can't say that you don't know what a step is. And these concepts of steps are so entrenched in our society. Even Alcoholics Anonymous says there's 12 steps, okay? You have to take these steps in order to, which by the way, I look at these and how much they include God, and so many Alcoholic Anonymous organizations now, or individual branches or groups, have removed God. I saw some that put like the word deity or divine power or whatever. And so you don't find freedom apart from God, guys. You might find a hiatus. You might find an oasis. But, you know, an oasis still has sand and sun for scenery. You're just under a tent with some water. No, you need to get out of the desert. And the only way to get out of the desert is one step at a time, and it's doing it with God's help. Okay, so I found about 50 scriptures on steps. Now, I can't read all of them for you. You can sigh a collective sigh of relief, because you know typically I would love to do that. But what I did was I took these 50 scriptures. That's about half as many pair of shoes as I have, I think. When you've done over, gosh, what have we done, Jude, 150, 170 shows now, something like that, 170 episodes in the can of the three, and Chris will say, this man will literally say, you wore those shoes last time, or you wore those shoes four episodes ago. You have to go get a new pair of shoes, and I'm like, okay, honey, I'll send it to you, that's fine. And so I don't do it every time, but I do have a lot of shoes. And there are a lot of scriptures on steps. This doesn't even count all kinds of other derivations of the word or shoes or anything like that. I just took these 50 scriptures, and they're going to be playing behind me here in a silent video. They're just going to be scrolling. And, you know, I really get excited about Rosh Hashanah every year. Rosh Hashanah, not just because it's the Bloom Hearts anniversary just about every time it rolls around, but because it is a time of year where the Jews say, go buy a new pair of shoes to remind yourself you're going somewhere new. And so I decided to go through all of my shoes in my closet and pick out some ones that the steps I took in them were very important or very memorable. So I'm going to go through some of those with you now. I actually am, let's see. I'm afraid you won't be able to see them if I do them over here. Mark, am I good sitting on this side? That's a thumbs up? Okay. He says, find your light. So I brought some of these shoes today. And I'm going to share some important steps with you, okay? Let's see if I can do it like this, because I'm technically going to need like six hands. Now, you all have seen me bring these out before. These are my war boots. These are my stomping boots. These are my dusty stomping boots. But I will never get rid of these because I believe the first time I sang that You're Somewhere in the Future song, I had these on. I mean, I would stomp. Y'all think I can stomp at near 60 years age? You should have seen me stomping in my 20s and my 30s and jumping up on a chair to do it and running around the congregation. So these were the boots that I often did that in. I have been known to put them on again in, you know, whenever I need to do that, or I'm in a place where I feel like I need to just do some warfare around my house, which for me is just some really intense and active prayer. I'm letting my body cooperate with my spirit in prayer. And y'all, it does something in the spirit realm. The devil's afraid of these boots. When he sees me pull these out, he's like, oh, snap, this is not going to be good for me. And so, you know, when I went digging to find, I mean, they're cracked. I doubt they're real leather, but I won't ever get rid of them because I birthed breakthrough in these things. And, you know, I urge you to look at the things that are going on in your life. And I think the reason I would urge you to look at these things and to find something tangible that you can remember from this season of your life, something that's linked to your breakthrough, it's the same reason that God told Joshua, take all these stones, build an altar, tell your children in the future, every time you stand here at this river, this is what God did for us and how he delivered us. So when I look at these boots, I just think, I'm still alive. That was the main thing in these boots I was stomping for, was stomping the spirit of death. And so those things, they seem so small, but they are not small. Okay, I got to come out of these. See if I can do it. I may have to have your help, honey. Help. Thank you. Should have worn a little pair of hose or something. All right, these first ones are actually just some little shoes that, oh no, that's the wrong one. Okay, I'll wear one. That's a slipper. It looks like this. These were some little shoes that I bought the first time we went to London, which was about 13 years ago. And we had saved forever to go, like years, remember, to go. And we had hardly any money, and I got there, and I did not have the right shoes to walk for. I mean, well, that last time we walked 28 miles. You walk a lot when you go there. And so Chris took me in a shop and got me these little shoes, and they have been through everything. They were not expensive, but I absolutely love them. And one time I remember they got gum on them, and I was so mad that I stepped in gum, which, by the way, just put them in your freezer and then just pop it right off, okay? But I was so mad. And I got these in London as well. We went to this little place. It had like a, I don't know, these cost £5, which was about $7.50 at the time. I don't buy expensive shoes. I just love little shoes, little things that can remind me of places. So there's those. And I rarely wear them because they just glow in the dark practically. And, okay, these were the shoes that I wore in the Mrs. Tennessee America pageant on my 40th birthday. Gosh, no wonder I didn't win. These are ugly. Okay, look at those. Snazzy, huh? And I had to dance in them, y'all. I can't dance. Like, so that was kind of hard. But anyway, there's those. That was a fun memory. It was a great way to turn 40, very distracting. These are actually Chris's. These came from Scotland. We got to our bougie hotel. I guess it's like this. Do you have two pair? It looks like I have two left feet. Anyway, so these are Chris's. Aren't those cool? They're posh little slippers. So those came from Scotland. And you know, every time you put one of these on, I close my eyes. Some people buy coffee mugs. Some people buy picture frames, whatever, when they visit a place. I like shoes. These came from, do you remember where? Amsterdam. Look at that, the heels off. But these came from Amsterdam. We went there it was really a layover because we were in Helsinki, Finland, praying for the Russian Jews. And we wound up in Amsterdam, and we got to do some amazing things. We got to go see the Ten Boom house where, the Anne Frank house. Yes, the Anne Frank house. And, you know, you walk in the front door and there's the bookcase and you move it back and it goes up to the stairs where they hid the Jews and the family there. And it was just powerful. So that's what happened in those shoes. And I sometimes think about it. More slippers. These came from a little place it's one of our favorite little bed and breakfasts, called Snug Harbor Inn, and these are on Catalina Island. And I actually started the Healthy Living Handbook in these shoes. We went there, and I had to start that book, and I remember just putting these on and was like, Lord, inspire me. So I looked down at these shoes, and I just think, and they were free there, you know. They're not, none of these shoes are expensive, but they're just things that remind me of steps that I took, times I had to do something or got to do something that was really significant. these socks belong to my good friend Sheila. And before you think that's really gross, she had several pair of surgical medical socks at the end of her life. And so when I would go and sit on what we called her life bed, never her death bed, but I would, they allowed me at the end to just take things that I wanted. And this woman and her walk changed my life, absolutely changed my life. And so I wanted so badly to, and did, got to, her daughters let me take some things from her house. Okay, this is another pair. You're going to have to help me with this, honey. When my stepfather graduated to heaven, thank you, I'll just talk and you dress me. So when he graduated to heaven, I did all kinds of fun things. I got like my, some of his shirts, and Brittany's mama made them into some pillows, you know, the buttons, like I can literally just lay, it's like I'm laying on his chest. It's so fun. And I asked for a pair of his socks. And the reason I did that was because whenever I was sad, I would lay in Pop's lap and he would say to me, honey, time wounds all heals. And so I had Brittany's mama put that on the bottom of some socks. Time wounds all, and you know what it does? It does. Time wounds all heals, but also time heals all wounds. Both are true. So there's those. And I have another pair of socks. This is the oldest visual aid that I have. These are my 1978 cheerleading socks. Go Panthers! These help me go higher. Like, Laura, why do you keep these things? I don't keep everything, and I'm very organized, am I not? Yes. But I am very sentimental. He says heavy on the mental. But it's true, I like to keep things that remind me of where I've been and of important moments. So I do. I have put those on before. If I need a spring in my step, I put those on. But these are the most important first steps I ever made in these shoes. Okay, come here, Prince Charming. You got to do this again. And these were from 1984 when I married this guy. And the thing about these shoes is that, yeah, it is like Cinderella. That's why I called you Prince Charming. We got married and, put that around, yeah. And so we got married and the thing was that we didn't have money afterwards for me to get a new pair of high heels. And I was working. I had to go back to work eventually. And so I had to wear these, and I remember just distinctly when I wore the caps off, there's no caps on them. I was really embarrassed. I thought, most people put their wedding shoes in a box and they let their daughters wear them or something. See how bad that is? But I had to do it. There's even some of the leather that's torn. I had to do it because that's all we had. So my wedding shoes got a lot of first steps and months worth of steps out of them, probably a year's worth. But those are important because I took my first steps as a married woman in those. My first steps really as the future mother of Camp Smith. And those were important days. Let's see if I can do it. They snap on pretty well. Thanks. So I want you to go home and look at the shoes in your closet, and I want you to try to imagine, thank you, dear, what some of the shoes that you own that you took some important first steps. And yes, these are looping. I have them on a, like it's looping four times. So if you see some of the same ones, that's why. I really wanted you to get them in your head. But that is, those are some of my favorite memories. And I want you to go and look through your closet. And I want you to say, what did I do in these shoes? Maybe this was a pair of shoes that I wore on a first day somewhere. Or maybe now you'll in the future go, this is an important day. I'm buying a new pair of shoes. It's why the Jews do it at the Jewish New Year, because they say that it's an important time for you to prophetically do something that tells you, I am making a step and I move forward. Yes, a new step. As we said, sometimes you have to go higher, not just forward. Sometimes it's the step on a ladder. And I am fascinated with the story of Jacob's ladder in Scripture and how he literally dreams and sees these angels ascending and descending. Now, can't you just hear this conversation with God? Okay, hurry, scurry down. All right, come back up. Well done. All right, go back down. You know, he's sending and commissioning angels. And that's what the Psalms tell us, is that they heed the voice of his command. You'll never hear me commissioning angels. And I don't mean to get into semantics, but Scripture says that they heed the voice of his word. So I always just ask the Father, Lord, send them down the ladder. Send them up. Send, you know, commission them. Send them out. I need them. And the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear them, right? So I think it's good, and I think we can expect this. But this is an occasion in Scripture where we see the importance of these steps. And think about in Daniel when, you know, Michael, the Archangel Michael shows up, and he says, Daniel, from the day you set your face to pray and fast, I've been trying to get here. But the prince of Persia withstood me. Now, there was no prince of Persia in this story. It was principality is what it was. It was a principality that was withstanding an arch, that was coming against this archangel. But can't you see, like, there's steps even to get the angels here. There's things that release that angelic activity. So I love this. Just go Google Jacob's ladder sometimes. You'll see so many pictures. It will really inspire you. And then I'm going to tell you a story about a time when I had something happen to me with steps. It was the last, maybe mid to late 90s, and I had been on anticonvulsants, really strong anticonvulsants, by this point for 15 years. So it would have been, gosh, then it was 93. It was not that late. It was before the mid-90s. And I just was tired of what it was doing to my body. It was valproic acid, and it was hard on my liver. Most people who stay on it have no enamel left on their teeth. Their teeth are literally mushy. When you smile, when they smile, you'll see, like, just it's mush. It's awful. I have seen the people who've been on it. It's a miracle mine don't have it. But I was really growing weary of the side effects. And so I got on my face one day. So you can either complain when you get weary, you can get mad at God when you get weary, or you can just go low. And, you know, it's just the best place to be. It's the best place to be when you feel that low. Because you can, before you step anywhere, you can just drop to your knees and ask God what that first step is. So I get down on my knees, and I think eventually on my face. I was back in my bedroom, and I was just asking the Lord about that. Now, eventually, he was going to have me come off. He was going to lead me off of that medication, and that began a whole other story that took me somewhere else, which included an invention, you know, for neurological disorders. But I will tell you that at this point, none of that was on my mind. I just wanted to stay alive. I didn't want valproic acid in my body every day. And so I said to the Lord, Lord, it's been 15 years on this stuff. And I believe you've said you're going to heal me. What gives? And I can't remember if he gave me, if I heard this passage or if I opened up in Scripture and there I was. But whichever it was, it hits you really dramatically when you're in the Scriptures, and it's like you turned there, or he gave you a passage and you open it up and it is your situation. Okay, so I want you to listen to this. I'm reading to you, I believe it's 2 Kings. I don't even have it on here, but I'm just going to read this to you. This is the story from Hezekiah, about Hezekiah. He had become mortally ill, and Isaiah, the prophet of the son of Amoz, came to him and said to him, "Thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live." Then he turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord, saying, "Remember now, O Lord, I beseech you, how I have walked before you in truth and with a whole heart and have done what is good in your sight." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. This is like what I was doing that day. Okay? So I kept reading. Before Isaiah had gone out of the middle of the court, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "Return and say to Hezekiah, the leader of my people, thus says the Lord, the God of your father David, I have heard your prayer and I have seen your tears. Behold, I will heal you. On the third day, you shall go up to the house of the Lord, and I will add 15 years to your life." Now he had my attention. "And I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city for my own sake and for my servant David's sake." Then Isaiah said, "Take a cake of figs." They took it, they laid it, they boiled it. He went on and then said to Hezekiah said to Isaiah, "What will be the sign that the Lord will heal me?" You ever done that? "Lord, give me a sign. Throw me a bone. Do anything. What shall be the sign that you will heal me and that I shall go up to the house of the Lord on the third day?" Isaiah said, "This shall be a sign to you from the Lord, that the Lord will do the thing that he has spoken. Shall the shadow," then he gives him a choice, "shall the shadow go forward 10 steps or back 10 steps?" He's talking about the clock, okay? Hezekiah answered, "It is easy for the shadow to decline 10 steps. No, let the shadow turn backwards 10 steps. Isaiah, the prophet, cried to the Lord, and he brought the shadow on the stairway back 10 steps by which it had gone down on the stairway of Ahaz. Boy, he had my attention now, because this mentioned the 15 years I was just sitting there praying about. And I believed, I got up off my knees and I said, "God is going to add 15 years to my life. I'm getting those 15 years back." I walked out of my bedroom and I walked towards the kitchen, and y'all know my back door is here and my steps are there. And I'm still thinking about all of this and how amazing it is to see, you know, basically a sundial, but go back 10 steps. And I'm just like, "Man, Lord, you're so good." And I look up, and this shaft of light is shining through that back door, the glass, onto the steps. And I just knew, I was like, "I know I'm going to count. It's going to be on the 10th step." And I started counting: 1 step, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It was the 10th step. God was giving me a promise. He was going to add 15 years to my life. Now, I believe that's literal, but let me tell you how I think he's done it. And I'm just bragging on God here. There are times I'll be somewhere and someone will say to me, "Really? I thought you were in your 40s. I thought maybe you were in your late 30s. The other day we were with my grandchildren and Avery, the oldest one. He said, "Lolly, how old are you?" No, don't tell me. And I'm sitting in a chair and he goes, I'd say early 40s. Which his mother is 37, so this isn't gonna, he knows that. He's super intelligent, he's 15. But every time somebody tells me that, I remember what God told me on my knees. So whether I live 15 more years or whether he stopped the age, he didn't stop the aging process, trust me. But whether he, you know, added it then or took me back or sustained me and kind of suspended me, I don't know what he did, I don't care. I feel like I'm in my 20s. I feel like I'm in my, there's no reason I should feel the way I feel with what I've been through. And the devil still doesn't leave me alone. He's still constantly nipping at my heels, constantly. But you know what is really cool? the God who created everything made me a promise. And that trumps anything that the devil would try to throw at me. So I tell him all the time, I'm like, oh, no, I'm not going to die. No. You can't kill me. You see, I'm not only going to live out all of my days. God had a number for me in his book, and he scratched it out and added 15 to it. And so I know I'm going to live a long time. Either that, or I'm going to be a 9-year-old who looks no older than 75. Which is okay. But anyway, you see what I'm saying? Like, the Lord will get creative in the way that he blesses you back and the way that he makes promises to you. And I love that about him. But what I want to get very practical with you right now on is what steps you need to take for whatever your situation is that you can ask God, how do I get there? How do I get there? Kelly and Will, you got two fine degrees. Two fine degrees, but you need jobs, right? And you got to get the jobs because the wedding depends on the jobs. So they got some steps to take. Deshaun, I know you're taking steps right now. You may feel like you're sitting still. Oh, no, brother. You are moving at warp speed in the spirit realm. So the devil's not going to be able to keep up with you. So everything else was going to line up exactly as it's supposed to go. What is your next step? What is it you're supposed, you may be like, I don't know, that's the problem. Well, then let's talk. So, for example, maybe it's a business model or an invention, a goal that you're trying to move towards. Maybe it's a problem you're just trying to get out of. It could be just a pattern in your life you want to see broken. I just don't want to do this thing anymore. And there's tar on my feet, and I can't get out of here, can't make the next step. Yes, you can. And I believe that if at the end of this sermon, if you had a counter on the word step, I'm probably going to have said it 1,000 times. I believe you're going to get the first one here today. So I'm going to talk to you about, it's what the world would say is a 6-step process. If you are trying to get a business model, if you are trying to do something, a business, an invention, or whatever, this graphic I'm going to show you is actually, it's an image which depicts 6 steps towards, I think they call it the innovation process, and leading on up to the patenting process. So, no, it's the last one. The last one. Yep, keep records. Meet with patent attorney. 3, research idea. 4, perform patent search. 5, build prototype. 6, take the product to market. Now, that is not how it happened for me. Here's how it happened for me. 1 is suffer for 38 years. 2, believe God's promise to me. 3, make a promise back to God. That is very important. 3 is very important. 4, receive the remedy in prayer. Now, for me, I'm talking about how I did for the longest time, wasn't sure that God wanted to heal people. Then I decided he would. Then I'm like, oh, that means he's going to heal me. Okay, I'm good till noon. We'll see what God can do, and I'll tell everybody at dinner what he did. You know, this was my mentality. And so, and he has done that for me before. He has instantly healed a rib that was broken, reinflated a lung that had gotten punctured. And I'm talking about he did it like that, and the before and after, you know, x-rays, we put them up on Facebook to show how one day the rib was broken, the next day it was not. He healed me instantly. So I get the instance, trust me. But there are times when he does it by process. And so that's really what 4 is I had to sit with the Lord and say, well, then, Lord, you told me you're going to keep me alive. So how are we doing this? And for me, it was a neurological blend. It was just an essential oil blend. I was just really making it to help my own brain, you know, function better and be calmer. 5 for me was test, bottle, trademark the remedy, and go to market. Because as soon as I created the first bottle, again, for me, I was weeping the night he gave me the composition, and it took me by surprise. He said, I want you to do a test case study, get little bottles. I was like, you want me to give it away? I just made it for me, what? And he had me divvy it up. We started doing case studies. We got it trademarked. We went to to get it trademarked. You got to have a web page proof of commerce. Shekinah bought the first bottle, paid a check for the first bottle for Joshua. And we were in business. Step 6, write the patent, go on international TV, stop others from suffering. That is the part where you give the devil a black eye for whatever he did to you. This is not the way the world does it. Remember up here, it was do your research and then go to market. No. There's plenty of things that will work for. But there are other times when you have to get with the Lord and get from him exactly what it is, your situation, you think it's just for you at the time. You are so focused on you, that's okay. Stay alive, stay listening to Jesus. I'm glad you're there. But at some point, look up and realize he's birthing ministry in you. If your marriage is suffering, perhaps you are headed for the ministry of reconciliation, and you are going to be able to sit with other couples and go, I know, I've been there. Nuh-uh, you don't have to quit. Let me tell you what we did. Maybe it's healing in your body. Maybe it's with your finances. Maybe it's with your children. Maybe it's something with your parents. Whatever it is, and you don't know the way out, so many people quit right there. It is basic 101 that you don't quit. Don't quit. But that's not even all there is. You got to get up and deliver all the other people behind you who are trying to quit. That is where ministry is born. So yeah, you may be right now trying to muddle through. You may be like, well, good for me. I'm still praising Jesus. There's more to this, folks. You got to get up. You got to quit feeling sorry for yourself. I understand the devil tried to kill you or your health or your marriage or whatever it is. I am not minimizing that. Y'all, I've lived almost 6 decades. I've seen it all. I've been through almost everything. But I am telling you, if you will get up, if you will get your eyes off of your navel and you will look up and decide, okay, why is it taking me so long to get across this bridge? I must have 50 people on my back. I must have the world on my shoulders. Ah, each step is like molasses. Bigger babies take longer to birth. And there ain't a mama yet who said, stick it in, stick it back in. It's always get it out. You know, you just want to go. You want to, yeah, there's a point of no return where you have to keep going. And so I remember during those boot stomping years how we would look at each other and we would say, our faith says this bridge should be really short between sickness and healing. Our faith says that Jehovah Nisi should be, he should give us victory. He's our banner in this situation right now. It shouldn't be such a long bridge. Our faith says that Jehovah Jireh isn't going to make us lose this house. Why 3 times have we gotten near foreclosure? Why is this bridge so long? From what I have a need in to what God has promised to resolve it with. Why is it so long? Because you're not just doing it for yourself. The world is not only watching you. You might be writing a book on that bridge. I don't know what your bridge is, but you are not allowed to go to this church and quit on the front end of it. And I get it. That's not for a lot of people. But I hope I can inspire you today. Keep going. It is not an option for you to quit. It's not about you anyway. Do you or do you not want to influence others for Jesus Christ? Well, then expect the devil to hate your guts and trip you up every time he gets an opportunity. A righteous man falls 7 times and gets back up. Yes, up, not forward. All right. Sometimes it's just the first step that's the hardest. And I love this little graphic because sometimes you just feel like you're just stuck in gum or mud or muck or whatever it is. It's that first step. I want God to give you the first step so badly today. And if you're like, well, he already gave me the first step and I'm stuck here, then it's your next first step. Your second step. It's your next step. Well, remember I told you I was going to give you a million silly and significant visual aids and hope that at least one of them would stick. Okay, so I got a couple more videos for you. This one is of first steps. And I love this. That black blob down in the bottom right is Jason. And he sees Azzy take his very first steps. Now, this is their home cam. You can hear Azzy so proud of himself. Jad says, Azzy's walking. Jason's got his camera. Next week, he's not even looking where he's going. Falls down, gets back up. Take him a while. I've seen everybody else do it. Oh! So I love that. I love that because it captured the very first steps. And he'd had kind of a interesting little crawl. They had to take him to a chiropractor. They popped something into place, and wasn't it the next day? 2 days later, he stands up and does that. This sermon is your chiropractic adjustment, okay? I want you, if you're down on the ground, I want you to get up, and I want you to stand up, and I want you to keep going, and I want you to keep your eyes on the Father. Did you notice he wasn't doing this? He was doing this. He was watching the Father all the way. I love that. But here's one of my favorite walking videos. Let's watch this. It's little Joshua. Pick those knees up, Joshua. Nope, I've had enough. And I'm in his face and I'm like, nope, you gotta get up. Come on, buddy, you can do it. You can do it. You can do it. Mama gets him up. Now he really starts high stepping here. That takes a lot to get those knees up, guys. He's not supposed to be doing that. But one day, he's not just going to be walking on that carpet. One day, he's going to walk up these steps, and I'm going to put this microphone in his hand. I've seen it in a dream. And he's going to testify and tell you guys what was going on in his mind when he had no words. That's what he's going to. So be nice to him now. He's going to remember all of it. Sometimes the first step is definitely the hardest. I love the MLK quote. I found a picture of it here, the Martin Luther King quote. And it's just about that. It's about how, and people have said it in different ways, but he just said it, that it's not, you don't have to see the whole staircase, just take the first step. Just the first step. It's so important just to take that very first step, and I'm praying that God will give it to you today. Savoltos, Donna, you're halfway through the steps, the 12 steps for your chemo. You know what step 13 is that you have to get back to? I'll show you what it is. It's one of my favorite walking pictures of all times. And I took it on a trip we were at. Go forward. There we go. I was behind you guys on an elder trip, and you were walking so briskly, both of you. This was before the other surgery. Your legs, everything that happened to your legs. Like, this is your future. You have a lot of miles left to walk together. And so we are carrying you. Jesus is carrying you on that bridge. To the other side. Amen. Well, you can go back to that other picture. I want to get real practical for you, and let's talk about, remember my six steps from earlier? Let's talk about yours. The number one for you is going to be suffer. That's easy. You doing that? Okay. Number one, suffer. Step one, check. Step two, believe God's promise. You got to get in his word. How many times have you seen me stand on a Bible up here and say, how can you stand on the promises unless you know what they are? Read the word of God. Do not be a part of this illiterate generation that never reads their Bible. Open it up or you will start to believe everything else that everyone on the backside of the bridge tells you. They never even make it across. They never even step on it. You are different. You are going to believe God's promise if it's in scripture, or if it's like me, you have this passage in front of you that you open up to and it's like, oh my goodness, I was just sitting here praying about 15 years and here's a promise for me. Believe it. Doesn't take great faith. Take just a little mustard seed, just a little bit of child faith. Number three, make God a promise. The reason I said this is important is because, you know, making vows is important. It is. And so you don't just need to go, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I receive your promise and I believe that. Okay, everything's great. Just you and Jesus. You're on your knees, right? That gives you hope. And then you get up. The devil heard you pray that prayer. He's going to send everything in the world he can to get you to stop at step two. No, you need to say to God, I will never quit. I am making a vow to you today, and I will never break it. I will crawl if I have to. I will scrape my elbows on the ground until I get back up on my feet. I will walk. I will run. I will sprout wings if necessary, but I will not quit. I believe that God has a purpose for me, and I'm going to find, he's not forgotten me. He has not, just thrown me over here in a stepchild pile. Hey, I'm a stepchild. I had a great stepdaddy. So don't ever come under that complex that God's remembered everybody but me. It's just a colossal waste of time. Just make a vow to God that you're not going to do that anymore. Because I promise you it's not true. All right, step four is receive instruction in prayer. People in scripture received instruction, battle plans, actual battle direction. And they'd go out and God would say, stand here, don't fight, send the praisers out, whatever it is, you know. And they do it and by golly, it worked. The Lord knows your situation. He wants to help get you out of it. But so much more than that. He wants you to help other people get out of theirs. Number five, take a step of faith and be diligent. Take all other steps God shows you. Take a step of faith and be diligent to take all other steps God shows you. It can be tiny at first. There may be difficult ones. There may be some you got to get a running start for and jump. But you can do it. You can do it. God believes in you, and so do I. And then six, begin sharing your breakthroughs with others in the same situation. This is very key because it means that you're going to allow ministry to be birthed in you there. At some point, you're going to go, oh, it's not about me. I'm fighting for all these other people. I'm actually in a war. This isn't a battle. I'm in a war. And what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Kelly Clarkson was right. And not only that, but just biblically speaking, whatever you defeat in the spirit realm, you have authority over. You have to say, oh, no, 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 no. I've been in that battle before. No, 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 no. You will live and not die, and you will declare the works of the Lord. Sam Elliott, I've been with you are, you will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. And your joy will be full. Your joy will be full. I'm convinced that the deaf and dumb spirit, which is the only spirit in Scripture that Jesus ever named, legion identified itself to him. But he actually said in Mark 9 with the epileptic boy, you deaf and dumb spirit, come out. And it's interesting because the father at that point of the little boy said, I do believe, help my unbelief. Well, the Lord was talking to me this morning about that spirit of unbelief and how it's so prevailing in our culture right now. And I felt like he said, and I'm going to be watching for this, there's going to be an increase in that deaf and dumb spirit in certain places where it's allowed to be. I don't receive it here. We don't receive it in our city. I don't receive it in my home. It is constantly, though, I believe the Lord said to me this morning, because the spirit of unbelief is coming against the world right now, it's the spirit of apostasy, if you think about it. It's trying to steal the faith of others. Because that's happening, you're going to see a rise in neurological things. You're going to see a rise in those, the deaf and dumb spirit. Well, I'm like, okay, then, Lord, I'm poised and ready. I got some anointing oil. Let's go. Let's go. I want to see an end to that spirit. Don't you, Sam? I want to see an end to it. But its main goal is actually not your health. It's your faith. It wants the spirit of unbelief, right? It wants to shut you up and close your ears to any kind of hope. That is what the deaf and dumb spirit does. And so you just have to look at it and say, oh, no, not me. You picked on the wrong person. So that's what I got for you today, folks. I want you to remember that everything that you do in your situation that you're trying to get out of is important. It is a step. And so I'm sending the ram now. I want you to stand up with me. And I just want you to say it after me. It's very simple. Kelly, I added you. It's so simple. I already see a typo. All right, repeat after me. The mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. Amen. I already see some of you liking it. So the thing is that if you can get it in your head that the Lord is the one, that he's not on vacation, he is, you know, not asleep, he has allowed this to pass through his hands to you, just corrected it, to you so that he can give you authority over something and you let a lot of other people come after you on the bridge. Oh, you're the blessed one. You're the blessed one. You are not the tail. You're actually at the head. That is what is so amazing about your journey. So ask God for the steps. But more than anything, put on your faith shoes and take them. Amen. I pray over you right now in the name of Jesus, no matter what situation you're in, it is not permanent. Whatever hard situation you're in, it is only temporary. If you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, keep walking. Keep moving forward. And I declare over you the words from Isaiah, those who wait upon the Lord, they will actually mount up with wings as eagles. Picture this. They will walk and not faint. I get all that. They're going to run and not grow weary, but you're going to mount up with wings as eagles. So everybody say it with me. Up, not forward. Because up is forward. All right. I love you all so much, and I understand that sometimes it feels better to wallow, doesn't it? And you know why we don't have a lot of wallowers at this church? I don't know if you've noticed. We don't, because they get very uncomfortable. They get very uncomfortable. It feels better to wallow, but you're not a wallower. You're getting a plan. Bridget, you said, I can't get here. The gas money, it's a challenge. But I'm tired of not being here. My plan is, my step one is, I come every other week then. And then God started providing for that. God bless you. I see you going through with your plan. He's got a plan for you, for your job, for your marriage, for your health. And whatever step you're on, we are there with you. We want to help you get up and get to the end. Amen. Well, God bless you all. Have a fantastic week. Listen to this last song as we're leaving and just bless each other with hugs and encouragements today, all right? Amen. God bless you. Yes, if you need prayer, come on up. But you can just be blessed with this song as you go as well. And we love you so much.